continue our studies. So far we have introduced four Euclidean postulates and we derived many results out of them. All these results we called neutral geometry, the union of these results. And then when we start doing constructions in neutral geometry, we realize that we cannot always complete the investigation, or we don't always know how to prove the result we obtain will be really the result we need. And it usually concerned two lines intersecting or non-intersecting. We need another axiom. And we will introduce this axiom a little bit later today. But so far let's start with the notion of parallel lines. And then we will introduce the Euclidean parallel postulate. That turned out to be essential for a few constructions we cannot complete otherwise. Before going anywhere delving in these matters, I want to prove a little lemma which is actually listed as a problem in the textbook, and I am pretty sure we proved it somewhere during the course of our studies of neutral geometry, but I will mention it again and I will refer to it numerous times. In neutral geometry, and you know what I mean by neutral geometry, the set of results based derived from axioms 1, 2, 4, the sum of two interior angles of a triangle is less than two right angles. The proof is very easy, the proof is trivial. Let triangle ABC has angles, angle A will be alpha, angle B beta, angle C gamma. We will prove alpha plus gamma is less than two right angles, beta plus gamma is less than two right angles, and alpha plus beta is less than two right angles. That's what we are going to prove. So let's draw this triangle just convenience, and we will extend one side, so it will be triangle ABC, and this angle is alpha, this angle is beta, and this angle is gamma, and I also need this angle delta. Let delta be an exterior angle adjacent to two gamma, and therefore delta plus gamma is two right angles. By the exterior angle theorem, alpha is less than delta, and therefore if delta plus gamma is two right angles, alpha plus gamma is less than two right angles, and beta is less than delta, and therefore beta plus gamma is less than two right angles. And then we can consider one of the exterior angles adjacent to alpha or beta and prove the remaining inequality. So I will just say similarly, alpha plus beta is less than two right angles. Quod erat demonstrandum. So we have completed the proof. So the angle sum of any two angles in a triangle, sum of two, two interior angles, is less than two right angles. And now we will proceed in studying parallel lines. Question. Do we need parallel postulate in order to have parallel lines or to define parallel lines? And the answer is negative. It's a very common illusion that we need parallel postulate to discuss parallel lines. We do need it at some point and for some specific matters. But otherwise, the definition: two lines are said to be parallel, to each other, if they lie in one plane and they do not intersect. It's important to know that really two lines that lie in one plane and do not intersect, they're parallel, yes? So, straight like this, this line, for instance, and this line, they look like parallel, approximately, yes? But in space, if they don't lie in the same plane, these two lines, so-called skewed lines, they are not parallel, they are not lying in the same plane, right? They are not intersecting, but they don't lie in the same plane, so they are not parallel, they are so-called skew lines. So, that's why we need this necessary to mention lying in one plane, and they do not intersect. The theorem. Are there parallel lines at all? We know that two lines cannot intersect in more than one point. It follows from axiom one. But maybe all lines that lie in one plane must intersect. Maybe there is no parallel lines. So, parallel lines exist, and I will emphasize again, in neutral geometry. Don't need a parallel postulate. The proof, this will be the best proof we have, a constructive proof. Not only, it will contain a part of proof by contradiction, but it will be a constructive proof. We you can construct this parallel line. So let A be a line and A an exterior point of this line. Line A. What means exterior point? Point not lying in line A. So this is line A and this is point A. From A drop a perpendicular AB onto A, and I will specify B lies on A. You should always explain what you are doing. You should always explain your notations. Whenever you are doing something, even if it's not an exam, if you are solving problem for your own, for yourself, for entertainment, still do it properly. Introduce your notations, describe them. So we draw perpendicular, B lines on A. Then from A, keep writing here, I need some room there. From A, or through point A, draw a line M perpendicular to AB. You know, it's one of the standard constructions, so we can do it. I will draw a line M perpendicular to AB. Let's show that M is parallel to A. By contradiction, suppose M and L intersect at some point C. So I can draw it like this. Suppose we extend them far enough and after a long while they intersect at some point C. Then there will exist a triangle ABC two right angles, which contradicts to the exterior angle theorem or to the lemma we proved just a minute ago, which contradicts the exterior angle. I will write briefly theorem 4, 5, 1. I remember this number because I used it so many times. Therefore, M and L do not intersect in the line I'm plane, are parallel. The right notation is M parallel to L. What was required to be proved? I will write like this. M two lines parallel. Do we have necessarily to use right angles? You could do without right angles. You could actually construct, draw through point A or another point. If this line is alpha, this line, draw it beta equals two right angles minus alpha, and then the result would be the same, right? Because the sum of angles alpha plus beta cannot be equal to two right angles. It must be less than two right angles, according to our lemma. So it's another way of proving that parallel lines exist. So we have proved, we constructed a parallel line. And now, in a similar manner to how we proved this theorem by contradiction, and using the lemma that we proved in the beginning of the class, you can prove the theorem concerning various angles formed by two parallel lines, two lines and a line that intersects them, in which case we can conclude that lines are parallel. So suppose we have two lines, M and A, and they're intersected by a transversal line T. It's called a transversal. Transversal has more general meaning in mathematics and geometry. It is a curve or a surface that intersects another curve at some angle. It does not stick together. They really intersect. Yes? They don't. It's not like tangent to a curve or tangent to a surface. It's not transversal. It's a tangent. Yes? A transversal must really intersect. So we have a bunch of angles here. I will call this angle 1, this angle 2, this angle 3, this angle 4. They have special names. This angle will be, of course, 5. This one will be 6. Oh no, this must be 5, right? By meaning, that's narrating the same and corresponding order. This must be logic in your notations as well. This will be 5, yeah? Because it was 1, so this is 5. This is 6. This is 7. And this is angle 8. So, if by the lemma that we proved in the beginning of the class, by the lemma, I will formulate the result and prove together. So I refer to lemma so you know it is true. If angle 1 plus angle 6 is two right angles, the lines are parallel. Like which lines? M and A. M parallel A. Right? It's a similar proof. If the lines intersect, then we have a triangle with the angle sum. I have it right here. Otherwise, we would obtain a triangle with the sum of two angles equal to two right angles, which cannot be. Right? which contradicts to the lemma. Contradicts the lemma. That's the whole proof. These angles, angle 1, angle 6, are called exterior. Also, angle 4, angle 7 are also exterior. And of course, if angle 4 plus angle 7 equals two right angles, they're supplementary, then M is parallel to L. Then, of course, you can prove the remaining, because angle 2 equals two right angles minus angle 1, right? So, therefore, it follows if angle 2 is congruent to angle 6, then M parallel A. Similarly, I will just write the remaining result. I actually mention how these angles are called, but first I will mention this result. Similarly, angle 1 congruent to angle 5 implies M parallel to A. Angles like angle 1 and angle 5 are called corresponding angles. Corresponding angles. Corresponding angles. Also, angle 2 and angle 6. Angle 2 and angle 6 are also corresponding angles, right, in a lazy manner like this. Also, of course, angle 4 and angle 8, angle 4 and angle 8, and angles 7 and angle 3 are also pairs of corresponding angles. So you should know the name corresponding angles. So if corresponding angles are congruent, lines are parallel, what other kind of angles we have? Because angles like angle 8 and angle 2 are kind of opposed to each other. And angles like angle 5 and angle 3, they are so-called alternate angles. So if angle 5 is congruent to angle 3, or angle 8 is congruent to angle 2, alternate angles congruent, then it follows M parallel to A. So we saw that if angles have this property, then lines are parallel, right? If lines are parallel, can we conclude something about the angles? That's an interesting question. And here we have to step, that's the moment starts when we have, is the converse of this theory. Or inverse of this theorem. Is it true? What would be inverse of this theorem? Inverse of this theorem is the following. Angle 1 plus angle 6 is two right angles. Then lines are parallel, yes? What we have proved. Angle 1 plus angle 6 is two right angles, then M parallel L. What if angle 1 plus angle 6 is not two right angles? The inverse of this theorem, the inverse of this statement, right? I will write here an inverse. Does it follow that lines are not parallel? And that was a question we encountered a few times when running investigations for our problems in neutral geometry, and we were not able to answer these questions. Moreover, not only we with our, humble efforts, but with our modest attempts, but the best mathematicians of the world during 2000 years could not answer this question. They could not answer this question in a different context. Euclid introduced a special axiom for this case to tell that if this is not, if one angle 1 plus angle 6 are not two right angles, then the lines are not parallel. He introduced a special postulate, and many mathematicians doubted whether this postulate is independent or we can prove it in neutral geometry. It turned out that it was independent. I did mention a few times how it turned out to be, how people proved it was independent, but now we will introduce this postulate and collect the consequences. So, now we will introduce the Euclidean parallel postulate. I will do it slightly differently than the book, not really differently, but in a different order, which seems to be more natural. So, it will be axiom number 5. We call it the Euclidean parallel postulate. Or just briefly, fifth postulate. It's a notorious postulate because people suffered so much trying to prove it, and it turned out to be impossible. So I will just formulate briefly. Remember, maybe if you look at the Euclidean book, especially translated into over 100 years old English, it sounds like, if a line falls on two lines so as to make the interior angles on one side less than two right angles, then the lines on which this another line falls will intersect in the half plane where the angle sum of these angles is less than two right angles. I want you to read it. You have this reference and I posted the excerpt from the Euclidean book. And I will just formulate it briefly. If you have line M and line L, and they're intersected by a transversal T, and they form angles alpha and beta, these are the interior angles. So the postulate sounds like this is alpha and beta are the interior angles. And the transversal divides the whole plane into two half planes, right? And as any other line, it divides the whole plane into half plane 1. And two half plane. And half plane two. So the Euclidean parallel postulate says if alpha plus beta is less then two right angles, then it follows M and L will intersect in half plane 1. That's axial in formulation like this. So similarly, we can talk about other consequences for angles, but usually interior angles is the most convenient one. It would have been probably enough to say that they will intersect up to here, because saying in half plane 1 is a little bit superfluous. Why is it superfluous? Because if this angle alpha plus beta is less than 2 right angles, then this angles delta and this angle gamma, if alpha plus beta is less than 2 right angles, then delta plus gamma will be greater than 2 right angles, then it's clear M and L cannot intersect in half plane 2. So this statement about intersection in half plane 1, of course, it is superfluous. It would be enough to say they must intersect. Yes? So it would be more rigorous to say so fifth postulate. That's how Euclid said it, but you can actually say the fifth postulate, alpha plus beta is less than 2 right angles. Then M and L are not parallel, will intersect. It's pretty clear they cannot intersect at half plane 2, because other in half plane 2 we would have had a triangle with the sum of two interior angles greater than 2 right angles, which is impossible. Yes? So such a triangle is impossible. In neutral geometry, right? And we do have all the results of neutral geometry holding. We just are going to get new results. So it is enough to say this. So these lines will not be parallel. It is the inverse of the theorem we proved. The inverse. Why do I write modestly in brackets? I can say it is the inverse of what we have proved earlier in neutral geometry. What was that statement? If alpha plus beta two right angles, then M is parallel A. Now the statement is true. The inverse is postulated to be true. Yeah? Inverse postulated in axiom 5. Inverse true, therefore converse is also true, right? What would be converse? corners. If M and L are parallel, M parallel L, therefore it follows alpha plus beta equals two right angles. That's a very important statement which allows us to perform so-called parallel translation. Also, converse, of course, implies also converse. M parallel L, then the corresponding and alternate angles are congruent. It's not, I will write it more proudly here. Follows now from the fifth postulate. Draw this picture again. As a converse theorem, right? This is transversal. I think we call this angle 1, 2, 3, 4. This was 5, 6, 7, 8. Converse of the original theorem or from axiom 5 follows what is converse is logically equivalent to inverse, yes? If alpha, if M is parallel to L, then angle 1 plus angle 6 is two right angles, or it also falls M parallel to L, then angle 5 is congruent to angle 1, or angle 1 is congruent to angle 5, and for the other corresponding angle the same, M is parallel to L, then alternate angles, angle 5 is congruent, or angle 1 is congruent to angle 7, alternate angles. Angle 7. This one is especially interesting one because it actually tells you that if you have a line, another line, right? This angle, I give it a name, theta, and this angle, eta, obtained by parallel translation, are congruent to each other. Eta is congruent to theta obtained by parallel translation of, suppose this is M, L, and T, of M along T. You see what I mean? I mean that if I have this line M, it forms certain angle eta is transversal T. If I perform parallel translation, it will form the same congruent, not the same, but congruent angle theta with a transversal T. So this is a notion of a parallel translation. That's the one that we were missing in all our constructions that we could not complete. And we will use this parallel translation in construction problems a lot. So let's stop here. We introduce a parallel postulate, and in the next lecture we will discuss the most important consequences and result we can obtain from the parallel postulate.